What is up, everyone who's part of the Game Leap family? Today, we're going to be looking at an Invoker game. This player is currently Archon 5. And the reason why I want to talk about this match is I want to really point out the major mistakes that 2K, 3K, and 4K MMR players are making in the mid lane. I think this will help the majority of the community. And really what I want to point out is things that you guys can apply immediately. Things that you can fix next game. And what I really recommend you guys do is you pick out a couple of concepts from this video and actually apply them, because otherwise you're not gonna get better. So hopefully you take my advice on that tip, take a couple of tips, apply them, and I think you're gonna learn a lot. So let's get into it. Following this Exort Invoker on his journey in the 2K or 3K MMR bracket. And yeah, let's see how he does and what mistakes he makes. Also, if you're interested in more of this content, we're putting out a lot of actually mid lane guides. If I heard correctly, there's also a Shadow Fiend mid guide coming out soon. So if you're looking to learn the mid lane mechanics from top tier players, I'm actually not kidding. There are multiple top tier players making content for the site right now. So if your goal is to make it to the top, I recommend you click the link down below right now before moving on with the video, because this one, I think it's going to take a lot of your brain power. So before you watch this video, click the link down below. And I'll see you there. All right, so let's hop right into it in the laning stage. I want to point out a couple things right off the bat. Number one, he didn't preemptively put down his ward, which is just, it's really a bad habit. So always put down your ward at the beginning of the game. Number two, if you're a good player, you need to generally eat your iron branch, Tango, if you're going aggressive or if you're getting pressured in the first wave. So it's actually a major disadvantage to not have your Tango, your shared Tango, in your inventory. On top of that, I would really like to see him buy a salve or extra Tangos as his first starting item to potentially win the lane. The reason why I think he can particularly win this lane, even though Exort Invoker is not strong really, in fact, Exort Invoker is actually pretty weak in the first levels, is because this Void Spirit is very, very low and is going a bit of a greedy item build to start, right? He has the null recipe queued up too. He does have a salve, which he might buy, but there's a big HP discrepancy right off the bat. And I would love to see this Invoker abuse that, right? What I would like to see him do is maybe just instead of going for denies and last hits early on, well, you can do them here and there, but primarily put your focus on simply harassing the enemy. So right here, you could fake this deny and then just hit him, which he actually sort of does. That ward is just terrible, and he pulls creep aggro before being in attack range, which is another massive mistake. And then here, I once again think he makes another mistake. Misses the last hit, gets the deny, and now here, I would like to see him fake this deny. Now, why is it good to fake the range creep deny? Because what is the typical player's reaction when it comes to low range creeps? Well, it's pretty simple. They have to secure it, right? They have to get it. They have to get it. So what do? You just fake auto attack it and then start punching him. Literally right here, instead of going for this deny, because you know this guy has his E, right? He's gonna try to secure it. You fake the auto attack, he's gonna step up, boom, boom, three auto attacks. I'm serious, works every single time. But instead, he doesn't do that. On top of that, he doesn't sunstrike the range creep, which he should have done, because guys, just, if you have a nuke, I don't care if it's sunstrike, if it's gush, if it's wild axes, if it's puck orb, you secure range creeps with nukes. Otherwise, you miss uphill and you overcommit. A bit unfortunate, right? I get why he auto-attacks, but because of that, he loses around 200 HP, and now he can't eat his Tango, making him lose more creeps, right? Gets denied there. These little things add up. If you're trying to become the next MMR bracket, if you're trying to gain MMR, you can't casually make these mistakes and be okay with it. You can't not sunstrike a range creep. You can't just miss a last hit because you have to take out your Tango, right? These are things you have to fix. And now here, once again, I don't know where he's going. I legitimately don't know where he's going. I have to rewind. But basically, after you miss the CS, waves on the hill, right? What do you guys think you do as a mid laner when the wave's on the hill? Every single time without exception, otherwise it's a mistake, you pull it back. There are very specific matchups where you can leave it alone, such as like Monkey King against a melee hero, right? You can just kind of hit them. Even then, you might want to pull it back just to bait your opponent in. But he doesn't do that here. He doesn't pull it back, and he gives this guy a free deny. Why did you do that? Why do you just give him a free creep? Now he's level 2 before you, and he's actually able to pressure you very hard here. On top of that, you should have eaten your Tango a while ago. Thankfully, Speedy is not so speedy on Shaman. I mean, come on, Shaman. You can't have the name Speedy and play bad. That's an insult to me. I'm actually kind of... damn. I bet you Speedy's about to pop off later on. Actually, let's check. Speedy about to pop off. 5, 4, 18. Good items. Let's go, baby. Alright, moving back into point though, I really think he lost his advantage. Only 2 CS in the first 2 waves, considering this Void Spirit came in a lane with almost no regen, right? No health, I should say. You didn't punish it at all. Which, guys, you have to take advantage of advantages. I don't know what else to say. You have to look at your replay and say, why did I not hit this guy more? Why didn't I bait the knives? Right? Things like this, because if this is Weehan Invoker, this Void Spirit either has 0 CS or is dead. It's one or the other. One thing that also pains me a little bit here is his lack of focus on denies. He actually ends up fixing it, and I'm not gonna lie, a lot of the things that this Invoker does in the landing stage is pretty good. I really do like some of his things, but that's the thing. It's always like these players can do the weird complex stuff that we're about to see in a bit, but they can't play the lane properly. Like, their fundamentals are so brutally bad, but they do like complex combos. And guys, just stop doing that. Especially if you're like some fancy mid player, please stop focusing on the fancy plays and focus on like getting good at securing creeps and pulling the wave back and harassing when you can and buying regen. Like, these fundamentals are, I know people don't like hearing this because they don't want to think they need to focus on the basics, but you do. Guys, I focus on improving my basics every single day. When I was trying to get to high MMR, I would improve on every little thing. Creep aggro, how efficient can I be? How quick can I buy my regen? How quickly can I use the shop? Like, things like this. And then I got really good at it. And then all this other complex stuff just came with time, right? It came with time. Also here, just be very careful. I see a lot of Exort Invokers do this where they look for Sunstrikes too much in a lane. Like, that's cool, look for Sunstrikes, but just kind of throw them out because now you end up, like, for some reason, all the way by your tier one and you're not able to deny two creeps, right? Those are two creeps you could have denied. That could be a big deal, right? Imagine if this guy hits six before you do. All of a sudden, because you didn't get those denies, he has kill opportunity on you. It's a really big deal. I don't think people look at it like that, but I really wish people would look at it like that. So here you do a pretty good job of auto-attacking. Once again, could have been a bit more deny priority. But overall, pretty good harass. Pretty good. So this right here is the most triggering thing in the game to me. I don't get why people do this. Like, don't you understand that if you drop your nose and eat the mangoes, you get more mana? Oh, not only that, you didn't even need the mana in that point in time, so you could have used it or kept them for a little bit longer to get the HP regen. Efficiencies like these that, like, why not do it? I don't understand. It takes no effort. So moving on here, he actually makes a pretty good play. Does a good job actually comboing up the Shaman. I like the target priority going on the Shaman and not the Void Spirit. So he goes for the Cold Snap, Tornado Meteor, and that's what I'm talking about. Like, this is a nice combo. It was a good reaction to kill the Shaman. But at the same time, like, why can you do that so cleanly but not lane properly? You know what I mean? I know it's actually a bit easier to practice combos like that than mastering all of the laning stage. But if I'm a player like this, or if I'm getting into this guy's head, I'm very nervous that his thought process in Dota is how good can I combo people when I'm level 5, you know what I mean? Instead of doing the things that actually make you significantly better faster, he's focused on these kind of one-off combos that, like, it doesn't teach you about Dota, it only teaches you about Invoker, and it's really like, I don't know, hopefully you guys kind of see what I'm saying with that. And upcoming here, I'm only using this clip because I just want to give my perspective on it. I think a lot of people would look at this and be like, oh my gosh, this Invoker is so good, how is he only... how is he only Archon 5? But the reality is, because all the little things are off, this play only needed to be good because he's done everything wrong, right? He wouldn't have to make this major outplay if he did all the little things right. He's not crushing the lane. He could have crushed this lane if he does all the little things right, but he doesn't, right? So instead, he has to make these, like, weird outplays, you know, the Invoker outplays. So he gets gone on here. Thankfully, the Void Spirit misses the Remnant. Otherwise, he would have died 100%. And now, he does, a good play, the Tornado into a Cold Snap. Gets out of vision, hits a Sunstrike, pretty good stuff, right? But the thing is, that was never needed if he laned everything else well. And I want you guys to look at it. Is this 3-0, meaning he's crushing? I don't think so. In fact, if we look at the net worth, he's barely above this guy, right? He's barely above him. Now, you might ask, how is that possible? Well, you know, this guy's 0-2. How is the Invoker only 100 net worth above him? It's because the Void Spirit has better last hits, 7 more, which matters actually quite a bit. And on top of that, kills just don't matter that much. They don't. Also, this TP is weird to me. I mean, I guess the Pudge might have killed you, but you lose out on a lot of XP. So overall, guys, I just want you to keep in mind, how you win mid is not necessarily kills. I really prefer when people get maybe like one kill, but then because of that kill, they actually can continue to dominate the lane because they buy, you know, enough clarities in the salve. Or early on, they zone out that Void Spirit so they can build up a level lead. And then after zoning him out, they get 15 or 20 denies. And because of that, they're 3 levels up. But the way this Invoker is playing is not how you crush Dota. It is how you sort of just be flashy. And funny enough, guys, I just want you to look at this. I really, really do. Because I hope this is eye-opening for a lot of you guys. I really do hope this is eye-opening. Look at the scores! This guy's 0-2! The Invoker is 3-0! And he's losing a net worth! He's behind a net worth! How crazy is that, right? How crazy is that? But that's Dota. I just want people to see this. You have to learn how to crush your lane based on creeps. And the way he could do that is obviously by casting spells and getting kills. that helps, but a large majority is he could have used the Forge Spirit a lot better, right? A lot better to get more denies, and he could have used that HP advantage to pressure the lane too. Now he's up on XP, which is great. He's winning the lane in that regard. I'm not going to deny that. It's by quite a lot too, right? This guy is just barely 7. The Invoker is 8 and some. So I'm not going to say that the Void Spirit is beating him. He's not, right? These kills matter. They are good, but he is not crushing him, which is the big thing I want to point out. On top of that, he gets caught up a lot in Sunstrikes here, which I know I've already talked about, but the reason why I'm oh my god, he's dead! Now he just feeds away his kill streak. But the reason why I want to point out him getting too focused on Sunstrikes is now he's dead because of it. He overextends, he's not paying enough attention, and he has yet to flash farm a single camp, right? At this point in the game, he could just meteor the wave, and then after meteoring the wave, you know, go farm a camp. Or he could pressure into mid tower, or then look for Sunstrikes. But instead, it's all backwards, right? It's all backwards. He's just constantly looking for Sunstrikes and kills. Like, dude, you're playing Exort Invoker, not Wex. If you want to play like this, play Wex. That's the build that lets you look for kills, but this style of Exort just is not efficient. It's really not. On top of that, I want to talk about a very common issue that players have that is the reason that they die. So I want to talk about this Invoker's movement, guys. If you're on the enemy team and you're trying to gank him, what do you think the Invoker is going to do next? It's actually very obvious because he's done it for 11 minutes straight. He's going to try to pressure the enemy mid laner. But I want to ask you a question. Does Exort Invoker kill a Void Spirit ever? Yes, if you're dominating him, but once Void Spirit is the same level as you and higher net worth, I mean, I wish this guy had a wand, but you know, when he's the same net worth, you can't cast any spells. You can't meteor him. He's just going to dissimulate or he's going to astral step away. You can't do anything to him. So why is Invoker continuously trying to pressure to one guy he can't? Why even waste the time doing that? You know what I mean? Why not go run at the bottom lane, the Skywrath Mage, who you easily can combo? Instead, he's just wasting his time throwing out spells on someone he can't kill. This is what I need you guys to think about. Am I putting my focus on people I can kill, or am I wasting my time trying to pressure I can't? Basic question, but no one asks it. Or at least no one's experienced enough or has spent the mental power trying to figure out this very important question. Am I ganking or pressuring the people I can pressure? Because I don't think you are. I would much rather see you enable your Legion by maybe ganking the Legion lane, or at the minimum, not being predictable and farming, you know, pushing out the lane with a Meteor and then farming a camp nearby, pushing up your net worth lead, then looking for Sunstrikes. That's my favorite way of Exort Invoker because it's very basic. Shove lane, right? Jungle, look for Sunstrikes. That works too, but you're doing neither. What you're doing is simply looking for kills on a mid laner you can't kill. This doesn't make sense. It doesn't add up. This is not how you want to play Dota. On top of that, if you were clicking on the Void Spirit, you should see that he has a Void Stone, and in that case, I probably am not going to buy an Orchid. Sure, you could argue you can Orchid the other heroes, but I don't like that. I don't like it at all because this means that you're going to be unbelievably squishy. You're going to have an Orchid and no stats, and you're going to be super squishy, and this means you're going to be right-clicking, which means you're going to be out of position. And overall, hopefully you guys get my point with that. And by all means, guys, I really do want to be clear. You can buy Orchid on Invoker if you get ahead. I've seen this build. I think, like, Sumaya is doing it or whatever. It's probably why, like, I looked at the recent matches for Invoker to get the game for this video, and, like, half the Invokers had Orchid, and I'm like, what the heck? This used to be some Wex build, but, like, Exort Invokers are buying, and I'm like, this is definitely some Sumaya thing, and I believe it is, if I'm not mistaken. Once again here, I want to talk about predictability, because this is a major sticking point for me. This Invoker is unbelievably predictable. I've played against Arteezy a couple times in pubs, and this is not me trying to flex on you guys. This is me trying to make a point. I've played against him. It is almost impossible to read his movements in the majority of games, especially if he's doing well. Man, you can't tell where he's going to be next. It is super hard to read him. It is, because he understands that if you become predictable, you die. And that's what happens here. Invoker's been trying to solo kill whoever comes mid. I wonder how we could bait him in. I don't think it takes a scientist to figure that out. And what do you know? The Skywrath Mage, actually, I don't think Skywrath was actually trying to bait. I think he was trying to kill him and kind of just made a mistake. But nonetheless, he gets the silence off, which enables the Void Spirit to kill the Invoker. And what do you know? Invoker overextends, becomes predictable, and dies. And the last thing I want to say before moving on into the later stages of the game is, guys, look at his team comp. Do you think the Invoker needs to solo carry this match? Do you think he needs to scale, right? Does he need to be the solo carry? He has a Mars core and a Legion core, two heroes that scale fine. On top of that, he has a Luna support who will also scale if the game goes long enough. So all I'm trying to say is that he could go Wex this game and make plays. Now they have a lot of disables, they have Spear and they have duel, so Exort is okay. I'm okay with you going Exort here. All I'm saying is that I wish you would try to enable your teammates instead of solo killing people all the time mid when you're falling behind. This playstyle works if you're ahead, not when you're behind. Okay. Okay, so quickly, we're going to go over two more fights before I end the video, because I really do want to focus a little bit on team fighting so you guys can see some issues as well. And upcoming here, we're going to see a major invoker issue where most invokers are so used to doing tornado combos and never relying on teammates that they just grief team fights. I see this all the time when I'm watching invokers. It's crazy. They always just lead with tornado because they're too used to it. Guys, you have to trust your teammates to initiate. Right here, your team makes a smoke play. That's awesome. But trust them to go in. I know people, they're gonna be like, I can't ever trust my 3K teammates, they always make mistakes. Nah, but I mean, in all seriousness, you have to believe in them. You do. I mean, even though this Legion, like, I don't know what that blink was, this great Chain Frost comes out. Look at this Chain Frost. This is a god Chain Frost. It doesn't get better than this. And what do you know? Oh, here comes the tornado. Like, you know, it's a good tornado. It is. But at the same time, it's bad. And it's because he doesn't have faith in his teammates to cast their spells. I will admit, though, it did set up for the arena. So I'll give him some credit there. All I'm trying to say, though, is that have some faith in your teammates. This applies to any mid laner. When your team is smoked up, trust in your initiators to set up for your spells. Especially if you're playing Invoker. You have to. Otherwise, your hero's kind of trash. Nonetheless, that fight actually went super well, so props on getting a smoke play coordinated.
Hey though, of course, we got the 3K MMR mid bleep.
This is all you guys do. Like, I haven't watched this clip yet, but I'm going to tell you exactly what happened. I'm serious. I have not watched this clip. I'm going to guess. I'm going to leave this in the video, regardless if I'm right or wrong, okay? Because I've watched a lot of pubs, and I'm telling you, this problem happens every single game. Every single game. Your team just pushed the bottom tier 2 tower. Now you think that the next objective, because you're snowballing, quote unquote, even though you're like 5 gold from your BKB, you could reset and fight with BKB, which makes you 10 times stronger because their enemy team is like a gajillion magical damage and stuns. You need the BKB. Instead, what your team is going to do is push to tier 2 mid, and now you're going to overextend. Now the alternative, before I look at the fight, is to take, dun 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 dun, Roshan. Why not just take Roshan? Your team insta-kills Roshan, you have a Luna with this spell, you have a Legion with Presti attack and Alacrity, like, just go kill Roshan, please. Then, what do you think happens? The enemy team funnels up, they walk down this hill, 3-man tornado into an arena, GG, the fight's over. But instead, I'm gonna guess that you guys dive the tier 1 tower, you overextend with some duel, and you lose the game because of it. Look, I can already see the pings coming out. Ah, what do you know? You're fighting under their vision, Lich gets jumped, shocking, okay? Fight comes out. Good Sunstrike. I mean, I'd love to see a Meteor. It's taking you kind of a long time. You should really Orchid someone. Orchid this guy. No, dude, Orchid him. Don't let him stun you. Okay, you disengage. That tornado is actually pretty good. Tornado EMP. I'm cool with that. Okay, Alacrity coming out from the side. You're overextending way too far here. What are you doing, man? Like, this Shaman kill doesn't matter anymore. How did I know your team would overextend? Like, to be fair, you guys actually didn't dive the tier 2 tower, so I was a little bit wrong there. But nonetheless, I'm pretty sure this is their ward. You guys have to fight on their ward. They get the initial pickoff because you're fighting under their vision and not your vision, and you lose the fight. On top of that, there were so many mechanical errors here. Like, I'm just gonna rewatch it one more time before I end off the video. But right off the bat, I can tell there's some issue with trusting your teammates. Why did you make... I don't know why you have Ghostwalk, to be honest. You should have made Meteor much earlier. You do cast it eventually, to be fair. So not too bad. Bit of a mistake on the combo. Not awful. But then, your awareness in the fight is a bit off. And this is a lot of practice intuition, so I don't blame you here. But yeah, you had to Orchid this guy so he doesn't stun you. Orchid is an insta-cast, his stun is not. So you shouldn't have gotten stunned there. Regardless, pretty good tornado into a good EMP. I like that a lot. But now here, what do you think you should do after this arena comes out? You should follow up the arena. You should go to the side and help out your team, right? You can kill this guy. Don't overextend and chase him. This guy is dead to you. He's dead. He's out of the fight. Let him go. Sunstrike and kill the Skywrath, who's literally killing your Mars. He's killing your Mars and you're not helping. Like, don't chase some Shaman under the tier 2. Like, it's just so foolish. You want to stay compact in fights. You want to stay together. Because then you don't overextend, you don't get picked off, and you can actually synergize your damage, which is very important in Dota. And what do you know, if you had BKB there, that fight would have been 10 times better. But all I'm trying to say, guys, is kill Roshan. Stop trying to kill mid-tier 2. I can't say this enough. Please, I hope this burns into your head. Every single pub that is, like, below 7k MMR gets thrown this way. And I'm not saying that in an ego. I'm saying that to help you. Please understand what I'm saying, but thank you guys so much. I hope you really do enjoy it and learned a lot. I personally enjoy making these videos where I look at low MMR games and point out their mistakes. I hope it really makes some things go through your head that you can fix immediately, because if you can fix these things over time, you will gain MMR, because that's how it works. So thanks for watching. Once again, check out the Game Leap website down below. We're posting a lot of cool content for everyone who's super active and watches to the end of these YouTube videos. I'm going to guess you obviously like the content, so you're going to like what I have to post on the Game Leap website as well. So thanks for watching. I'll see you in the next one, and peace. And hey guys, remember, before you end this video, in the link down below, I've been playing a lot of live games where I talk about my thoughts in real time in the middle of a Dota match. So if you want to get in the head of a pro player, click the link down below to the Game Leap website. Super cheap right now, right? Like, and I'm doing this a ton. We all have time on our hands. I have time to make content. You guys probably have time to enjoy and learn Dota, get better at the game. So yeah, if that combo works for you, click the link down below, and I'll see you there.